on very few platforms the Azilsartan has been talked about. So I thought this is a good opportunity to brief everybody and learn a little bit more about the efficacy and advantages of using this new generation ARB, that is Azilsartan. It's a common knowledge that hypertension is a very common illness and affects about more than 40% of industrialized population. And in majority of the hypertensive subjects, more than 80% we have associated.
Sir, sorry to interrupt. Slides are not visible. So can you?
Okay.
Just a minute.
Is it visible now?
Yes. Sir, you can make it full screen. It's visible.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
So, as I was talking about the prevalence of hypertension, it is, we know it's more than 40% of population is affected by it. And in large majority, as many as more than 80% patients have comorbidities and other risk factors like diabetes, dyslipidemia, CKD, cardiovascular disease. So it becomes very, very important to choose an antihypertensive drug, keeping in mind this patient's profile. These factors have to be taken into account while making a prescription for such a patient of hypertension who is sitting before you. The problem areas in the management of hypertension, we all know, which are to common knowledge to everybody, but I still feel it is a good opportunity to emphasize these problem areas, that is early diagnosis, because it's a silent disease, so not many people would consult a doctor, and the diagnosis of hypertension may be a chance finding on a routine checkup. So routine or annual health checkups are very extremely important in the diagnosis of such silent diseases. Second area of problem is compliance to treatment. Again, being a silent disease, not many patients take the advice of continuing regular treatment lifelong very seriously, and they would of their own downgrade the treatment or stop the treatment thinking they are feeling absolutely all right. Optimum blood pressure control is again a problem area, because not many patients go for regular blood pressure checkup, that is home monitoring, or they do not consult their physicians on a regular basis. So bringing down the blood pressure to target area level, where all the advantages of treatment of hypertension would be forthcoming, will be lost. So this kind of optimum blood pressure control is again a very problem area. Now, to deal with these problem areas, suffice to say that most important thing is to educate the masses about the prevalence of such a serious but silent disease. And not only that, I always felt that when you diagnose a patient with hypertension, the patient who is sitting before you, he needs a lot of your time on your first diagnosis session. You must educate him about the disease and emphasize the silent nature of the disease and the absolute need to continue treatment regularly, monitor it, and then only the benefits of treatment of hypertension will be forthcoming. So educating the patient and spending that much little extra time when you diagnose it for the first time is very, very important. Needless to say, this is applicable to most of the other diseases also, particularly silent diseases, especially like diabetes. Proper selection of drugs is again extremely important, because not only you have to keep into the mind the patient's severity of hypertension, but associated comorbidities, also patient's economic status, and choose a drug which will be effective, patient will tolerate that, patient will comply with that, minimize the dosing, preferably use the combination pills, two drug or three drug combination, that will improve the patient's compliance also. So keeping all these factors into the mind and preparing a prescription for such a patient, which I always like to call as a designer prescription for that patient, because this prescription should vary from patient to patient. Despite having same severity of the hypertension, but having a different profile, comorbidities, patient's educational status, his economic status, that should guide your prescription. And once you give him such a designer prescription, I'm sure the chances of that patient to comply with that kind of treatment for a long, long time are much greater. Also encourage the regular home monitoring and also use of ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, which unfortunately is not done that regularly or frequently in our country, unlike other countries. And that also affects the control of the hypertension, and we always lose the advantages of reducing the complications of hypertension in long run. According to the recent guidelines of hypertension of 2020, the ideal drug characteristics we all know should be that that drug should be evidence-based in relation to morbidity and mortality prevention. It should be possible to use it in one's daily regime so that you can improve the compliance. That drug should be affordable or should be cost effective in relation to the other agents. It should be well tolerated, and evidence of benefit of use of that particular medication in population to which it is being applied should have been evident. So all these are the characteristic of ideal drug, and one must keep this in the mind while choosing a particular molecule for a patient of hypertension before you. Now, initiation of blood pressure lowering treatment should always start with the advice about lifestyle modification, and then you should apply the drugs. In the first category of hypertensive patients, which we will call as a high normal blood pressure, where the systolic varies from 130 to 39 and diastolic 85 to 89. Needless to say, the lifestyle modification should be advised, and in large majority of such patients, if this advice is taken seriously, it would be effective and one may not have to use drugs. The one has to use drugs in treatment of such very high risk patients if particularly the patient has cardiovascular disease. And most of these patients, either having angina, MI, or heart failure, anyway, we are going to use beta blockers and ACE inhibitor. So they would serve the dual purpose of controlling this borderline blood pressure, as well as give them cardiovascular advantages. Now, then you have a grade 1, 2, and 3 of hypertension. Grade 1, where systolic 140 to 159, diastolic 90 to 99. Grade 2, 160 to 179, diastolic 100 to 109, and grade 3 beyond that, that is systolic beyond 180, and diastolic 110 and beyond. Now, in all these three categories, needless to say, we have to add drugs. The lifestyle modification is basic advice, but that would not suffice to control hypertension. In the grade 1, immediate drug treatment must be used in high and very high risk patients, that is patients who have cardiovascular disease or multi-organ dysfunction or renal disease. And in grade 2 also, we must use drugs immediately in all these patients, irrespective of their risk category. And so is the case with the grade 3 also. And we must aim at blood pressure control in 3 months. We must shed our inertia in up titrating the treatment for hypertension. This I have often noted in practice. We start with one or two drug and then keep on following the patient for months and months together. But if within 3 months, if you are not able to achieve the blood pressure on target, then without any delay, you must up titrate the medication. This is very, very important. Now, principles of blood pressure treatment in the target range is below 140. Unless you do that, the advantages of sufficient risk reduction are not achieved. If you keep the blood pressure hovering between 140, 50 or 140 to 60 and do not bring it down to below 140, then those advantages of risk reduction of hypertensive complication in long run are always lost. So this is very, very important to remember. In drug treatment of hypertension, patients who have established hypertension and is not under control with lifestyle modification, and you should consider starting the treatment when the blood pressure is constantly remaining above 140-90. This threshold can be raised to 160/100 only for those patients who are at lowest risk or are very elderly and frail. But in large majority of the patient, the threshold for beginning the treatment should be above 140/90. And our target to achieve with the treatment in a younger patient that is below the age of 65 years should be below 130/80. And those who are elderly beyond 65, the target should be below 140/90. Also, those patients who have ischemic stroke and TIAs, again, the slightly upper level of target, that is below 140/90, would be prudent. For proper blood pressure reduction or satisfactory blood pressure reduction, you must aim at reducing the systolic blood pressure by more than 20 and diastolic by more than 10. Once you have begun a drug, you can always check on the efficacy of the drug on this parameter. Uptitration to target following drugs. You begin with ideally the low dose combination of the two group of drugs, that is A plus C. A stands for either ACE inhibitor or ARB, and C stands for calcium channel blocker, particularly the dihydropyridine group. So you combine low dose of both these group of agents and then gradually uptitrate it to full dose of this combination. If blood pressure is not under control despite fully tolerated dose of both these agents, then you can add diuretic. And despite that, if it's not under control and you find the patient has a resistant hypertension, you have to add spironolactone. One has to consider other initial combination for specific patient subgroups. This is very important. We have always been bombarded with this concept that you have to start with either ACE inhibitor or ARB and calcium channel blocker combination, or ARB ACE inhibitor plus diuretic combination. This particular combination should be to begin with. But mind you, if the patient has certain other comorbidities like cardiovascular disease, angina, MI, heart failure, tachyarrhythmias like atrial fibrillation, or patient has sympathetic overactivity, anxiety, one should not flinch from starting a drug like beta blocker. And mind you, you will always get a very rewarding results if patient has sympathetic overactivity and you have begun with a single drug of beta blocker. One should try to use single pill combinations wherever possible, even two drug or three drug combined in single pill, because this is a lifelong treatment and patient would definitely stick to this kind of lifelong treatment only if he has to take minimum number of pills. And one can help this by preferring single pill combinations wherever it is possible. In the diuretic, one should try to use thiazide-like diuretic. And if that is not effective or available, then thiazide diuretic. And when less ideal agents are available, then one should, if the blood pressure lowering effect should be aimed at reduction of 20 millimeters of systolic or more and diastolic 10 or more. As I said, the sequencing of treatment of hypertension by choosing particular drugs, as I said, we begin with in the step one as a dual low dose combination of A plus C, and then go for full dose in the third step triple drug combination, that is, you would add a diuretic also. And when it is not under control with this triple combination, then one should add a spironolactone or some other drug. In the other drugs, at times one has to make a choice of like alpha blocker or centrally acting drug. Beside, of course, the beta blocker, as I already mentioned, in particular groups where it will be very, very effective, that is sympathetic overactivity, associated cardiovascular disease, or even in pregnancy and young women where ACE inhibitor and ARB will be fraught with the risk of contraindication because of pregnancy. So in that particular group, the other drugs must be kept in mind. In resistant hypertension, I have often felt that the alpha blocker is also a good choice. Although in practice over the years, I have seen not very many physicians, they start using alpha blocker once they find patient having resistant hypertension despite all four combination. That is ACD, and then you added spironolactone. And particularly elderly male with, you see the prostate enlargement problem also. The alpha blockers makes a very good choice. Of course, one has to keep in mind the some side effects like postural hypotension, particularly elderly people who have a senile postural hypotension also as a risk factor, must be kept in mind. But otherwise, I have felt that alpha blocker is also a very, very good choice in such group of patients if there is no other contraindication. The core drug treatment strategy in uncomplicated hypertension, as I said, that you begin with the two drug, then add a third drug like diuretic, and then if not under control, then add additional drug. And needless to say that beta blocker should be preferred over other group of drugs if you have associated cardiovascular problems or pregnancy or sympathetic overactivity. Now, this combination of ARBs and calcium channel blocker have a very synergistic effect in the blood pressure reduction. You see, the calcium channel blocker, they produce arterial dilatation, they produce peripheral edema, they are effective in lowering in hypertension patient. They reduce cardiac ischemia also because they have vasodilatory effect on coronaries also, and they reduce afterload also. So they improve myocardial ischemia as well. As against that, the ARBs will produce venodilatation against the arterial dilatation by CCBs. So the chances of peripheral edema will get reduced. Also, the ARBs are effective in high renin hypertension, and they of course do not have any cardiac ischemia benefit, but they do have a renal benefits protection, and cardio in the patients with congestive heart failure, the cardiac benefits also. And ARBs, they produce RAS blockade, whereas the CCBs, they produce RAS activation. So this kind of synergistic effect of mechanism of action of CCBs and ARBs will increase the potency of blood pressure reduction, at the same time reduce the chances of side effects. Coming to our newer ARB molecule, azilsartan, the FDA had said that it decreases blood pressure. The decrease in the blood pressure, that is magnitude of the blood pressure reduction, rather than any other property of antihypertensive drug, is that is largely responsible for their cardiovascular clinical benefit. So this has to be kept in mind. It's the degree of blood pressure reduction that is most important factor in reducing the cardiovascular benefits. And greater the antihypertensive effect of azilsartan, it would serve to justify the clinical interest in recent use in the patients with hypertension. Why azilsartan is such a powerful blood pressure medication? Because certain special features have been noted about the azilsartan. The azilsartan has a very tight binding on AT1 receptor, and that provides a prolonged efficacy throughout the day. Also, the additional mechanism that appears to enhance the angiotensin 1 to 7 vasodilatory action also be contributing further to its efficacy. Also, there is a postulated effect of enhancing renal sodium excretion, which also might contribute to blood pressure reduction effect of the azacitidine. And that's why it has been found that it, compared to other ARBs, as we are going to see over next set of slides in various studies, the effect of azacitidine in terms of blood pressure reduction is much greater, and it's a long-acting drug as well. In the three studies which were published in the Journal of Clinical Hypertension in 2011, they compared the use of azacitidine versus the olmesartan versus valsartan. Dio-1 is valsartan, Benicar is olmesartan, and Edarbi is azacitidine. So if you see the orange bars which represent the azacitidine, they showed the maximum blood pressure lowering effect over six weeks in all the three studies, say about 20 to 30% greater blood pressure reduction in systolic blood pressure particularly over 6 weeks, and in the third study even over a period of 24 weeks. So this kind of efficacy of the azacitidine has been proven on these three studies which are published in 2011. Our response rate in terms of blood pressure reduction, if it is compared azacitidine against olmesartan and telmisartan, again you can see the azacitidine scores much better compared to olmesartan and telmisartan. Almost seven RCTs, which involve more than 6,000 patients, in which they compared the effects of azacitidine with various other ARBs, they found the reduction of the diastolic blood pressure in the clinic, as well as the 24-hour mean blood pressure reduction, both were much better with azacitidine. As you can see here on the extreme left bars, they represent the use of azacitidine 40 and 80 against ramipril. Then the azacitidine 40 with candesartan. In the third, with valsartan. Also against the olmesartan 40 milligram. And also against the valsartan and olmesartan, both. While using the azacitidine 40 and 80, I don't find much difference. Of course, with the azacitidine 80 milligram, the reduction in the diastolic blood pressure is slightly greater than 40 milligram. But even the azacitidine 40 milligram, if you see, it definitely fares much better as compared to other ARBs molecules, that is valsartan and olmesartan. So there is no doubt that the azacitidine, even 40 milligram, it shows much better efficacy in terms of reduction of blood pressure in clinic as well as 24-hour blood pressure reduction. In patients on who are on hemodialysis, they found that switching from olmesartan to azacitidine, it significantly and safely reduces the home measured blood pressure, both systolic blood pressure as seen in the left panel and the diastolic blood pressure as seen in the right panel. So switching did not alter the electrolytes, and it actually can reduce the cardiac mortality also. So switching from olmesartan to azacitidine gave much better results in terms of blood pressure reduction. It is also seen that the azacitidine improves salt handling when it was compared with the other ARBs like candesartan. Now, this potent antihypertensive effect of azacitidine, where blood pressure reduction of 20 systolic and diastolic 10 was found to be much better with azacitidine compared to olmesartan. And also, the blood pressure reduction was sustained for 24 hours because the trough to peak ratio was close to 1 with azacitidine as compared to olmesartan. So such a unique sartan, that is esilsartan, which gets our patient to goal for blood pressure, is possible by unique three-way effect. One, because it inhibits the AT1 receptor much better, it almost 10,000-fold stronger binding with AT1 receptor. It also reduces 20-HEAT, and because of that, it reduces salt and water retention. It is also supposed to activate the angiotensin 1 to 7 by mass receptor, and thereby it produces vasodilatation and it prevents cardiac hypertrophy and also attenuates renal damage and gets our patient to blood pressure goal and also offers cardioprotection. Therefore, in the Hypertension Journal of 2018, American Heart Association, it recommended that esilsartan should, which is offering additional systolic blood pressure reduction over other ARBs like olmesartan and valsartan, and also ACE inhibitor like ramipril, and should be preferred over these ARBs, and it definitely offers an additional 4 to 8 millimeters of mercury further reduction in systolic blood pressure compared to these compatriot other ARB agents. Beside this, in various articles, which are I'll show you in the next couple of slides, the in this particular study, which was published by Marriott and ETL, the esilsartan was found to be associated with increased circulating angiotensin 1 to 7 levels and reduced cardiovascular 20-HETE levels. So thereby, it offers an additional vasodilatory effect and also it reduces salt and water retention. In this article also, which was published in 2018 Jan, it was shown that esilsartan decreases blood pressure. It also reduces the urine albumin creatinine ratio, which is more than other ARBs, and it also exerted depressor and renoprotective effect. In this article, which again was published in Journal of Clinical Hypertension, it was concluded that the in highest CV risk cohorts, that is older patients who have CKD, the use of esilsartan and chlorthalidone combination to achieve blood pressure target is very safe, and it requires less dose titration and fewer additional antihypertensive medications to achieve the blood pressure target as compared to olmesartan and hydrochlorothiazide combination. So in elderly patients who have CKD, very high risk patient, again, this combination of esilsartan and chlorthalidone fares much better compared to olmesartan and chlorothiazide. This again, a part article published in Clinical Journal of Pharmacokinetic showed that there is no dose adjustment of esilsartan required for subjects of hypertension who have any degree of renal impairment, including end-stage renal disease. So this all goes to show that even these patients who have associated CKD and especially the end-stage renal disease, again, no dose adjustment is required for use of esilsartan, which is a very remarkable thing. This again shows the comparative blood pressure reduction when you use esilsartan and chlorthalidone combination versus esilsartan alone versus chlorthalidone alone. And you can see the yellow bars, which again was a study over 12 weeks period, and primary endpoint check was change in the systolic blood pressure in the clinics. They found when you use esilsartan and chlorthalidone combination, where esilsartan is 40 milligram and chlorthalidone 25 milligram versus esilsartan chlorthalidone 80 to 25 combination, and compared with the olmesartan hydrochlorothiazide 40 and 25 milligram combination. You can see the maximum change from the baseline systolic blood pressure was found when you use esilsartan 80 milligram with chlorothalidone 12.5 milligram. And the results with azelsartan 40 milligram with 25 milligram chlorothalidone were again very close to it. But they are definitely much better results compared to olmesartan hydrochlorothiazide. In this study, where three combinations were used, placebo combined with amlodipine 5 milligram, which represents yellow bar, azelsartan 40 milligram with amlodipine 5 milligram, which represents the light brown bar, and azelsartan 80 milligram with amlodipine represented by the dark brown bar. You can see the maximum reduction in systolic as well as diastolic blood pressure was achieved when you use azelsartan and amlodipine combination. With 80 milligram, particularly the diastolic blood pressure was slightly better, but the systolic blood pressure reduction were almost equal, 40 or 80 milligram compared almost same. Now, triple versus dual combination in lowering systolic blood pressure. One can see when you use amlodipine with chlorothiazide, olmesartan with chlorothiazide, olmesartan with amlodipine, olmesartan, amlodipine, and hydrochlorothiazide. When you use the triple combination, you have the greatest change in the systolic blood pressure. So it goes without saying, when you have not achieved the target with the two drug combination, addition of third drug, like diuretic, is very prudent. So to summarize features of our newer ARB, that is azelsartan, it's the most powerful ARB. Its use in the USA is growing particularly because of the superior efficacy and simple dosing, once daily dosing, and a single pill combination is available with chlorothalidone. Our country also combinations with blocker like cilnidipine is available. That makes a very excellent choice. With cilnidipine, which is a very popular and general blocker, and excellent tolerability and patient acceptance. It has a great place in therapy. I would summarize. Being a new ARB has a superior ambulatory and blood pressure lowering effect. Its response rate of this drug in its highest dose are greater than the drugs in the same class, that is like olmesartan or telmisartan or valsartan, by absolute rate of 8 to 10%. And because of this, the azelsartan may be useful treatment option in blood pressure lowering of patients who are on dual antihypertensive drugs, that is ARBs plus CCBs or ARBs plus diuretic, and have not achieved the target blood pressure. So before trying triple antihypertensive drug, I think switching over the ARB to a newer molecule like azelsartan is definitely an attractive choice. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a wonderful and lucid presentation on newer ARBs and hypertension management. I think there are lots of questions in the chat box. I will take it at the end of the talk together, so that many questions which will be overlapped, can be covered together. So now I request our second speaker for the day, Dr. Jagdeep Shah, sir.
Hello. Dr. Prakash sir has highlighted azelsartan in a much better way and the combination therapy. So I will be concentrating more on chronic kidney disease associated with diabetes. As we know, chronic kidney disease is a big problem. What you see abnormal creatinine dialysis and transplantation is just the tip of the iceberg. There is a lot below it. The burden of CKD is increasing day by day because of the aging population. Diabetic patients who are getting better treatment, they are surviving better. The cardiovascular intervention keeping them alive, and long-term cardiovascular disease. These all factors leads to increased incidence of CKD in general population. So if you see, the prevalence is 10 to 13% of the adult population in US, and approximately 35% of the patient with type 2 diabetes, they develop chronic kidney disease. And if you look at the US renal data system, the new cases of end-stage renal failure, 38% are from diabetes. And if you combine with hypertension, 25%. So almost more than 60% of the patient in any dialysis unit will be of diabetic or hypertensive nephropathy. Diabetic kidney disease, about 30% of the diabetic patients are likely to develop kidney abnormalities. And out of this, 10 to 15% of the diabetic patients develop end-stage renal failure requiring hemodialysis or a kidney transplant. And as we have seen, diabetic kidney disease accounts for majority of the ESRD cases. Major cause of morbidity and mortality among diabetic patients. And the main mortality and morbidity is in the first year of dialysis, where the chances of developing MI are four times greater than patient who does not have diabetes. And diabetes is a leading risk factor for renal impairment, as like you see, when we were studying, glomerulonephritis was a major factor for chronic kidney disease. Now diabetes and hypertension has taken over the majority cases of chronic kidney disease. And if you see the renal markers, which is low GFR and high urine albumin, they open up the door for morbidity events and mortality events like developing chronic kidney disease or developing cardiovascular disease and ultimately death. So albuminuria and low GFR both are independently predicting the renal output. As you can see in the chart, patient who has macroalbuminuria, the hazard ratio is maximum. You can see the chart. And those patients who have GFR lower, they also have a hazard ratio higher. So if you combine those patients who has macroalbuminuria with low GFR, the hazard ratio is much higher. And proteinuria also an independent risk factor for mortality in type 2 diabetes, as you can see in the slide, like those have macroalbuminuria, the survival rate reduces significantly. So up till now, for preventing diabetic nephropathy, what did we do? We aim to achieve good glycemic control, optimal blood pressure control, RAS inhibition, which is the main target of preventing diabetic kidney disease, and other multi-factor intervention like controlling the hyperlipidemia, controlling uric acid, low protein diet, supplementing with alpha keto analog, and some failed attempts like combining ACE inhibitors with ARB in an attempt to reduce proteinuria, which was failed, and so that combination has failed. And diet, physical activity, and smoking, they do help in preventing progression, but there is no randomized control trial. But logically, all these three things helps in good cardiovascular milieu, and so that should help in diabetic kidney disease also. In this slide, you can see from stage one of hyperfiltration or preserved GFR to stage two, 90 to 60 ml per minute, stage three, 30, 4, 15, and stage five. So as the severity of hypertension increases, the chances of progressing from stage two to stage five CKD is higher. and cardiovascular and renal risk also goes higher as the stage of CKD increases. But if you prevent the hyperfiltration at the stage of hyperfiltration and stage two, when there is a mild reduction in kidney function, then you can prevent the diabetic nephropathy progression, or you can even in stage one, you can regress it. And once serum creatinine increases, the GFR is already low, up to 60 ml per minute. And then it is usually a relenting progression to chronic kidney disease from stage two to stage five. Microalbuminuria progresses to macroalbuminuria. Then it, as the stage increases, the proteinuria also increases. So in a typical diabetic nephropathy, from microalbuminuria to macroalbuminuria to nephrotic range proteinuria, then renal insufficiency, and then from stage 2 to stage 5 CKD. This is the usual scenario of diabetic nephropathy, but there are variations of patient where there is normoalbuminuric diabetic nephropathy, and those patients who have tubular interstitial disease, or those patients who have more arteriolar disease. There you may not find a high degree proteinuria. So how do we select the antihypertensive drug? So we can select on the presence of subclinical target organ damage. So if the patient has left ventricular hypertrophy or microalbuminuria, then definitely we will choose a RAS blocker as the first line. And if the patient has history of cardiovascular disease or post-MI or post-standing, then or reduced ejection fraction, then beta blockers would come in. And if patient has a metabolic syndrome, then obviously RAS blockers are the drug of choice. Or we can choose the drug according to hemodynamic profile and based on plasma renin level, as Dr. Prakash sir has mentioned, that if you examine the patient and if you find that patient has signs and symptoms of fluid overload, then you combine with diuretic in the initial management. But if the patient is non-edematous, and like then you have to choose a drug. And if patient is not normal albuminuric, then you have to choose calcium channel blocker as the first line of treatment. So conventional treatment was diuretics, ACE inhibitors, calcium blockers, renin blockers, beta blockers, and sympatholytics. The up to like 2013, it was said that any of the five antihypertensive classes is suitable for initiation and maintenance treatment of high blood pressure. But now, like for CKD, if you see, we can divide like GFR more than 30 ml per minute and GFR less than 30 ml per minute. If the GFR is more than 30 ml per minute, ACE inhibitors or ARB is the first drug of choice, followed by thiazide or thiazide-like diuretic. And we will see up to what stage like we can use thiazide diuretic in the later slides. Then, depending on the profile of the patient, either beta blocker comes first or calcium antagonist. And then, as Dr. Vadirani sir said, alpha blocker is a fifth line. And if it is not controlled with this, then central adrenolytic drug like clonidine also helps in patient with CKD. And at the end, aldosterone receptor blocker can be used. But with chronic kidney disease, we have to monitor serum potassium very closely. Otherwise, like the chances of hyperkalemia in patient with CKD is very high. In patient who has GFR less than 30 ml per minute, ACE or ARB plus loop diuretic, as like thiazide diuretic would lose efficacy when GFR goes below 30 ml per minute. And if there is no proteinuria, as I said, calcium channel blocker would be the first choice, then calcium antagonist and beta blocker and alpha blocker and central adrenolytic is the same. Dr. Vajirani has already explained A plus C plus D. So if patient has volume expansion, then give MR blocker, that is spironolactone or aplanaron. But if the patient has sympathetic nervous system activity, give doxazosine or nebivolol followed by aplanaron or spironolactone. And for patient who has arterial stiffness, especially the elderly patient, alpha blocker like doxazosine should be tried first, then spironolactone, and then nebivolol. Aldosterone is a steroid hormone with mineralocorticoid activity produced by glomerular zone of adrenal cortex. It maintains the sodium and potassium balance and blood pressure control by binding the mineralocorticoid receptors in connecting tubule and cortical collecting duct in the kidney. And they increase the sodium reabsorption. So by blocking these receptors, you increase the sodium excretion and potassium retention. So another way to look at hypertension in CKD is when you see a patient with CKD with proteinuria and without proteinuria. So patient who has more of glomerular disease will have higher proteinuria, while patient who has tubular interstitial disease or vascular disease, pre-glomerular disease, they will have no proteinuria or minimal proteinuria. Patient with proteinuria, if it is having symptom or signs of edema, then first line is ARB or ACB with loop diuretic, and then non-dihydropyridine CCDs, verapamil or letrozole. But if patient with proteinuria without edema, then ACB inhibitor or ARBs are the drug of choice. Suppose patient does not have proteinuria and still having edema, first line is loop diuretics, then ACE inhibitors or ARB, and then dihydropyridine CCD. Patient without edema, first line is ARB and otherwise a calcium channel blocker. So progression to mild to moderate impairment of renal function from stage 1, 2, 3, and stage 3 is divided into stage 3A and B. From 60 to 45 ml per minute, it is stage 3A, and from 45 to 30, it is stage B. So thiazide diuretics starts declining its efficacy from the stage 3A. And you remember that all osmotic diuretics, loop diuretics, and thiazide diuretics, they work from inside the tubules. When they are excreted into the tubules, they work from inside the tubules. So whenever you are using these drugs, they require higher dose than the usual dose of diuretic. So if the GFR is low, you need to give higher dose of diuretic. And when the GFR goes below 45, usually you shift to loop diuretics. The exception is metolazone, which works even in stage 3, 4, or 5 CKD. It is the only thiazide-like diuretic, which is very potent drug, and it can be used in combination with loop diuretic even in the advanced CKD stages. So as you can see in this slide, stage 2, 3, from stage 3, you have to start considering adding loop diuretics, and from stage 4, loop diuretic plus combination of metolazone. So loop diuretics are particularly useful when treating edema and hypertension in CKD stage 4 to 5 patient in addition or alternative to thiazide diuretics. And among the loop diuretics, the main, like bumetanide, is not available in our country, but furosemide and torsemide, the main difference is bioavailability of torsemide is more, and it has a longer half-life, and it has got partial aldosterone antagonist activity. So potassium excretion is relatively lesser than furosemide. So if the patient has a tendency for hyperkalemia, you have to use furosemide rather than torsemide. If the patient has normal or lower potassium, then you use torsemide. And when you have to combine with aldosterone or a spironolactone or aplanaron, then furosemide is a better molecule to maintain the potassium balance. among the thiazides, hydrochlorothiazide, the bioavailability is 65 to 75% and potassium excretion is moderate. But chlorothalidone and metolazone, the potassium excretion is significantly higher. So especially metolazone should not be used frequently, and it should be monitored very closely. And giving daily metolazone to a patient who has GFR which is normal or up to stage 2 or 3 will likely to produce volume contraction, hypokalemia, and acute kidney injury. So metolazone drug to be used very cautiously. Dr. Vajirani has already discussed the target blood pressure. So if you see on the first, in 2017, the main blood pressure target, if you achieve at below 65 years of age, 130-80, and above 65 up to 140-90 should be reasonable. In early phases of diabetic nephropathy, aim for the lower systolic blood pressure which patient can tolerate, but provided the diastolic blood pressure is not going below 70. So if you can achieve the blood pressure of 120 and patient does not have symptoms of hypotension or giddiness or postural hypotension, then if you maintain that level of blood pressure for prolonged period, then it will definitely help in long term in all target organ damage. But in patient with a long duration diabetes with high risk of comorbid condition or in the presence of cardiovascular damage, avoid aggressive lowering beyond the guidelines, because the chances of complications are more than the benefits which you achieve by minimizing this much of blood pressure. So those patients who have a high systolic blood pressure and causing high pulse pressure, they have long-term cardiovascular risks. And those patients who have low mean BP and diastolic blood pressure, they have early mortality. So don't put early and late mortality in the same basket. So when you are aiming for the low blood pressure, there are two caveats. Like, you should not risk hypotensive episodes, and you have to measure the blood pressure in upright position, particularly in diabetic patient, and especially all long-standing diabetic patient, we should rule out autonomic neuropathy by measuring the blood pressure in sitting as well as in standing position. And in our country, where we have incidence of diarrhea, vomiting, fever frequently, the chances of developing hypotensive episodes are more. And if these patients are on ACE inhibitors or ARB, the chances of developing AKI is much higher. So do not attempt aggressive lowering of systolic blood pressure if diastolic blood pressure is also very low. So you, in blood pressure during dialysis session versus intradialytic interval, pre-dialysis blood pressure is usually 16 millimeter higher than the intradialytic blood pressure. And when we want to achieve the target blood pressure, it is in between dialysis home blood pressure, which is the target, and that is the best predictors of outcome. And arterial stiffness and weight gain are the best prediction of pre-dialytic blood pressure. So in a patient who is on hemodialysis, there is a dictum that unless proven otherwise, it is volume overload. So you go on reducing his dry weight till patient starts complaining of muscle cramps. So that means you have achieved the dry weight. And in spite of that, if patient is remaining hypertensive, then this means that there is a high renin hypertension, then you add azacitidine or ARB. Calcium channel blockers and cardiovascular protection in hypertensive patient with or without CKD, calcium channel blockers are excellent antihypertensive drugs. The presence of microalbuminuria and proteinuria forces the need to use ACE inhibitors or ARB, but does not impede the consideration of CCB as part of combination, as already been discussed. As you can see in the slide, like calcium channel blockers are indicated in all subclinical organ damage patients from microbiome with renal dysfunction to asymptomatic atherosclerosis to previous stroke. All patients can be started on CCB. Cilnidipine is a fourth generation dihydropyridine molecule originally developed in Japan. Unlike other calcium channel antagonists, the influx of calcium ion into both vascular smooth muscle at the level of L-type calcium channel and neuronal cells at the N-type calcium channels. The blockage of N-type calcium channels affects predominantly peripheral nerve endings of a sympathetic nervous system. So it reduces the sympathetic overactivity in patient, and so it reduces the vascular resistance. And cilnidipine, as you the ratio is 21, more 50 times more than that of amlodipine. So the net benefit out of cilnidipine is like you block the sympathetic nerve endings, and so you reduce the sympathetic nerve activity, reducing the vasoconstriction, increased cardiac contraction, L-type of calcium channel blocker is blocked by maximally by cilnidipine. And so you have a dual blockade, no reflex tachycardia, no paddle inhibitor, antioxidant effect, lowers the proteinuria, reduces the leptin-induced atherosclerosis, better ambulatory blood pressure control, and also helps in remodeling of vascular system. The only caveat with cilnidipine is it is not as powerful a drug which can be used in severe hypertension, but it is definitely a good molecule in patients with mild and moderate hypertension. So KDOQI guidelines, patient with diabetes and hypertension, CKD stage from 1 to 2, ACE inhibitors and ARB usually in combination with CCB. Patient with diabetes without hypertension, albuminuria, at the risk of high risk of developing diabetic kidney disease or its progression, also ACE inhibitors or ARB is suggested. But patient who have diabetes but no hypertension and there is no microalbuminuria, do not use ACE inhibitors or ARB. There is no evidence of any benefit of starting these two drugs in this set of patients. And the targets in diabetic nephropathy are many. Like you can reduce the oxidative stress, reduce systemic blood pressure, proteinuria reduction by solute oxide, glycemic control by all newer molecules. You can prevent the advanced glycation products and thereby reducing the glomerulosclerosis. You can control the growth factors by various antibodies. Dietary protein intake reduces the inflammation and reduces the hyperfiltration. Smoking, uric acid, vitamin D, hyperlipidemia, and inflammation is also now becoming a major target in patient with diabetic nephropathy. So there are like multiple targets in a patient with diabetic nephropathy. So you have to target all these factors to prevent progression of diabetic nephropathy. And with these newer molecules in horizon, empagliflozin and canagliflozin, the management of diabetic nephropathy is going to be shifted, and I think it will be taken by endocrinologists. And the GLP-1 analog, liraglutide and semaglutide also. So in summary, after many failed attempts, we now have at least 3 anti-diabetic drugs that improve the renal outcome: empagliflozin, liraglutide, and semaglutide. So if you see as what SGLT2 inhibition does, it causes afferent arteriolar narrowing. Thereby, it reduces the glomerular pressure, reduces the albuminuria, and renal protection is affected. And RAS blockade, it causes efferent arteriolar widening. So that's how it reduces the glomerular pressure, reduces the albuminuria and renal protection. If you combine SGLT2 inhibition with RAS blockade, there is afferent narrowing and efferent widening. So there is a balanced vasodilatation and there is potential for normalization of intraglomerular pressure with intraglomerular pressure reduction. There is a potential for long-term renal protection. Declining renal function also increases the risk of severe hypoglycemia. We know that any patient who develops hypoglycemia, we should rule out CKD. And especially patients who are on sulfonylurea, they are likely to develop hypoglycemia more frequently and more severe also. So how does that we discuss impact management in type 2 diabetes? Maximum RAS blockade should be ensured. Good glycemic control, blood pressure control, lifestyle modification. And if the patient has cardiovascular disease, inhibitor. Having diabetic kidney disease, EMPIRE outcome trial has shown positive results. So how does we slow down the progression of CKD? By blood pressure reduction, RAS inhibition, low protein diet, statins, anemia correction with erythropoietin and other supplements, smoking cessation, and possibly vitamin D. So in summary, like we have CKD, which has high prevalence worldwide, and to slow down the CKD, we have multi-target approach to be considered, and all therapeutic strategies we have discussed already. Prevention works. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you for a wonderful presentation on diabetes and CKD. It was very well presented from your side, and I think it will help most of the audience present here in their day-to-day clinical practice. Now I invite our third speaker for the day, Dr. Shaleen Shah, sir, for delivering his talk.
So I'll be brief in my presentation so we can have more time for discussion. Yeah, so I'll be basically discussing the paradigm shift in the management of diabetic hypertension with the newer guidelines in place. So as we know, hypertension is twice more common in diabetics as compared to non-diabetics, and the definition of hypertension in diabetics is generally similar to the general population. And threshold for treatment is persistent blood pressure above 140 by 90. We've discussed these points already. And as both hypertension and diabetes are associated with obesity, it is not surprising that the coexistence is particularly common in obese individuals. So we are more bound to see the combination of both these comorbidities in obese individuals. So patients with diabetes mellitus have more commonly present with isolated systolic hypertension, and they're more resistant to treatment. So because of the coexistence of diabetes and hypertension, we have two killers, and hence there is a significant increased risk of coronary heart disease, left ventricular hypertrophy, congestive heart failure, as well as stroke compared to the either condition alone. So the European Society of Cardiology guidelines in 2018, which is the latest ones, they show that the hypertension in diabetes is common, more dangerous, and treatable, and 40% of patients with diabetes have hypertension at the type of diagnosis of the diabetes. Diabetic patients with hypertension are at a greater risk for worsening cardiovascular disease as well as the CKD compared to normotensive diabetic subjects. And as you can see, they've categorized patients, hypertensive patients, into high risk and very high risk. And as far as diabetes is concerned, so diabetes with target organ damage such as proteinuria or major risk factors such as smoking or marked hypercholesterolemia or marked hypertension is categorized as very high risk, And most of the people with diabetes, with the exception of young people with type 1 diabetes, they fall into the high risk. So once you have got diabetes along with hypertension, you're more likely to fall into the very high risk or the high risk. There is a very small spectrum of people who do not fall in these two groups. So this slide is reiterating the same fact. As far as the stages of hypertension are concerned, we've already discussed those stages. So whenever you've got diabetes as a comorbidity, you are more likely to fall into the high risk or very high risk, irrespective of your blood pressure readings. Right. So what are the thresholds for treatment of a diabetic patient? So the same guidelines state that till the age between 18 to 79, in the presence of diabetes, of systolic blood pressure greater than 140 and a diastolic blood pressure greater than 90 millimeters of mercury, warrants treatment. And you can be, a little conservative as far as elderly patients are concerned, where the thresholds are 160 systolic and 90 diastolic. So what are the targets? So the previous slide was who should be treated, and so what should be the target in these group of patients? So younger individuals, that is between 18 to 65 years, the target is to achieve a systolic blood pressure of 130 or lower if tolerated, that is without any side effects of the medications, but generally not less than 120. So the 2013 guidelines of the European Society of Cardiology also had similar recommendation as far as the targets are concerned. But the 2018 guidelines were different in the sense that they also established a lower threshold of 120, which was not there in the earlier guidelines. Similarly, in patients between 65 to 79 years, the target still remains between 130 to 140. And it's the same for those above 80. And for the diastolic blood pressure, the diastolic should be maintained between 70 to 80 millimeters of mercury. This is because between 2013, there were some studies which showed that, aggressively lowering the systolic blood pressure to less than 120, especially in diabetic patients, was associated with increase in the CV morbidity as well as mortality. And hence, this new recommendation had come into place in 2018. So what are the problems with achieving, BP goals in patients with coexistent hypertension and diabetes? So variation in the methodologies to measure the office blood pressure. This limitation is also there with different studies which have been carried out with different protocols. Lack of 24-hour ambulatory blood pressure monitoring data from RCTs because of the effect of mass hypertension. There is lack of evidence of certain risk group of patients even among the diabetics, and it is difficult to balance benefits, benefit harms and costs. And majority of hypertensive patients are not at a reasonable, that is less than 140 millimeters of mercury systolic pressure. So studies have shown that only around 15 to 20% of the patients actually achieve their blood pressure goals. This is also considering the undiagnosed patients. So the proportion of undiagnosed hypertensive plus those hypertensive on treatment and not achieving their goals is significantly higher, up to the tune of 80 to 85%, which is a big number. So as I said earlier, why a blood pressure lowering to less than 120 or the target for diabetic patient as far as systolic blood pressure is concerned was kept at 130 millimeters of mercury. So this is one of the meta-analysis which was published in a Journal of Hypertension in 2017. And as you can see that as far as CV death and all-cause mortality is concerned, as compared to diabetic and non-diabetic patients, in diabetic patients, there was no benefit in decreasing the blood pressure to less than 130 millimeters of mercury. While in non-diabetic patients, there was still some benefit as far as the CV death and all-cause mortality is concerned. What is not shown in the slide is those between 130 to 140, there was a benefit of CV death and all-cause death in both the diabetic as well as the non-diabetic patients. But less than 130, it helps the non-diabetic patients, but may not necessarily be good for diabetic patients. So what are the goals of hypertension treatment in diabetes? So obviously the ultimate aim is reduction of cardiovascular risk and mortality. The treatment should be with acceptable side effects and simple to use, and treatment should be evidence-based, obviously, and cost-effective. There should be no interaction with other drug treatments, may it be antihypertensive or any other group of agents. And there should be a favorable 24-hour hemodynamic profile with lower arterial stiffness. So how do we treat hypertension in diabetes? So usually now this is a change in paradigm which we are talking about. So usually now the new recommendations have come up where they're saying that drug combinations are necessary. So preferably an ACE inhibitors or ARBs with a calcium channel blocker with or without a diuretic, as we've already looked at the algorithm, the A plus C plus D. So I'm not discussing into the details of the same. But as you can see, it is recommended that you initiate treatment with a combination of a RAS blocker with a CCB or a thiazide diuretic at an initial stage. That is, at stage one hypertension, they do recommend that it is better that you start a combination of treatment. Why so will be coming to later on. So Dr. Prakash has already discussed this slide regarding the grades of hypertension and the role of lifestyle management, followed by drug treatments with and without comorbidities. So this is one of the charts. I mean, all of you must be aware about it. This is the ADA 2020 recommendation as far as the blood pressure hypertension is concerned. So the ADA still says that at a blood pressure greater than 140, but less than 160 millimeters of systolic blood pressure, you start with one agent, and depending on whether the patient has albuminuria or not, you can choose the agents. But this is the difference between the two guidelines, the European Society of Cardiology and the ADA, where the European Society of Cardiology, are going for a more stringent and aggressive approach as compared to the ADA 2020. So we'll be coming to the evidence of the combination therapy. We've also discussed this slide as far as the initial combination therapies and the single pill combinations which are available. So just I would like to highlight one point that there is a limited group of people in which you can consider monotherapy as far as diabetics are concerned, and those are those with a low risk grade 1 hypertension, that is with a systolic blood pressure of less than 150 millimeters of mercury, or in very old individuals more than 80 years, or frailer patients. In these group of patients, you can maybe start with one agent, but in others, younger patients, those at a higher risk, you can start off with a combination therapy from the word go. So in 2013, the European Society of Cardiology had given a recommendation that initiation of antihypertensive therapy with two drug combination may be considered in patients with markedly high baseline BP or at a high CV risk. So this is where we come to a change. So now it is recommended to initiate with a two drug combination, preferably a single pill combination, and with the exceptions which I mentioned earlier, that is older individuals and those with a systolic blood pressure of less than 150 millimeters of mercury. So why there is no single drug therapy for hypertension? As we know, hypertension is a multifactorial disease, and it is regulated by various factors such as cardiac output, sympathetic tone of the patient, the fluid volume, the status of the renin-angiotensin system, as well as the peripheral resistance. So this is one of the studies in which they had shown that patients may present with various combinations of the pathophysiology as far as hypertension is concerned. So patients may present with a combination of sympathetic nervous system activation and sodium renal retention, or they may present with any of the three combinations in varying degrees. So with a proper history, a clinical examination, and with some help of investigations, we can make out which one of the three factors is the predominant one, and we can tailor the treatment in such a way. So this is one of the studies which showed that the combination therapy increases the blood pressure more effectively than increasing the dose of monotherapy. So this is the incremental systolic blood pressure reduction ratio of the observed to expected additive values. So as you can see that adding another drug from the ongoing treatment helped to achieve the expected decline in the blood pressure. However, doubling the dose of medication which was already going on failed to achieve the target which we were looking for. So for the major drug classes, the incremental effect on systemic systolic blood pressure lowering of doubling the dose of monotherapy is only 20% of that which is achieved by adding a drug from another class. And this is not limited. So this it's the same study. So it is not limited to one group of agents. So whether the patient at baseline was on a thiazide diuretic and another therapy was added, or was at baseline on an ACE inhibitors or another therapy. So irrespective of what baseline therapy the patient was on, adding another drug proved to be more fruitful rather than increasing the dose of the medication which the patient was already on. So the combination therapy is superior because we are taking care because we're taking, you know, we're taking the different pathophysiological mechanisms head on by when you give combination therapy rather than up titrating the same medication. So combination therapy is superior to sequential monotherapy for initial treatment of hypertension, and single pill fixed dose combination can reduce the pill burden and simplify treatment regimens, because they have a number of important benefits over the same drug given separately. They improve blood pressure control and lead to the normalization. They increase compliance. So in studies, it has been shown that patients who are on multiple antihypertensive drugs, that is two or more, the compliance rates were only 50%. So when you prescribe a patient, the patient not necessarily is taking those medications at the right time every time. So the compliance was only 50%. So once you give a medication in a fixed dose combination, it definitely will increase the compliance rather than giving the two medications at different times at different dosages. It increases compliance, it improves persistence, and it reduces the total as well as the CV related hospitalization cost. So as you can see, we'll be just briefly discussing the mechanism. We all know that the amlodipine has predominant effect on the L type of calcium channels. Cilnidipine is a drug, as we've discussed in the previous presentation, the molecule which is origin from Japan, and it has action on both the L-type channels as well as the N-type channels. And these N-type channels are basically present in the peripheral nervous system in the presynaptic vesicles. So what is the effect of cilnidipine on the RAS system? So the this was one of the studies in which was published in 2011, and it showed that the combined administration of cilnidipine with an ARB significantly reduced the noradrenaline content in the renal cortex. And this study suggested that the suppressive effects of cilnidipine on the ARB-induced increased RAS activity can be partly explained by its sympatholytic action on the N-type calcium channel blockers. So the addition of cilnidipine to an ARB may have a beneficial and coexisting role as far as diabetes treatment is concerned, and they may have a synergistic therapeutic effect. Comparing the cilnidipine with the earlier molecule amlodipine, so this was one of the study, a randomized active control study, which randomized cilnidipine plus a RAS blocker and amlodipine with a RAS blocker. And patients were assessed at baseline 12 weeks and 24 weeks after treatment. Urinary albumin to creatinine ratio was measured at baseline 12 and 24 weeks. So in the cilnidipine group, the albumin creatinine ratio was significantly reduced after 12 weeks as well as after 24 weeks as compared to amlodipine, which did not show any decrease in the albumin creatinine ratio. So the decrease in the albumin creatinine ratio was significant at 12 weeks as well as at 24 weeks with a significant p-value of less than 0.01. So this was another study which showed that for treatment of hypertension in diabetic nephropathies, we obviously know ARBs are the first line treatment. But combination of an ARB with a CCB in this study resulted in a reduction of microalbuminuria by 44% as compared to when ARB was given alone, where the reduction was of 9%. So there were definitely several limitations of this study, where in the plain ARB group, the blood pressure was also not that better controlled as compared to when the combination of therapies was given. But we also have molecular mechanisms by which it is explained that cilnidipine might have a nephroprotective role. So L-type of calcium channels are present in the proximal convoluted tubules, and the N-type are present in the distal convoluted tubules. So when you give amlodipine, it will basically cause proximal vasodilatation and increase the intraglomerular pressure, while by giving cilnidipine, it will cause some degree of proximal, but it will also cause a distal arterial dilatation, and it will cause a balance vasodilatation, which may have its role in nephroprotection. So this study, the ARB used was valsartan, and the CCB which was used was cilnidipine. Coming to insulin sensitivity, so this was a small study of 10 hypertensive patients who were evaluated for the effect of cilnidipine on insulin sensitivity. So they had measured the HOMA IER as far as the insulin sensitivity is concerned, and cilnidipine at a dose of 10 milligram was given for a total of 12 weeks. It was found that cilnidipine was metabolically neutral, that is, it significantly reduced the blood pressure, but not any of the parameters of glucose and lipid metabolism. However, the insulin sensitivity improved by 20.8%. So as we discussed from the earlier study, where it prevents the release of catecholamines from the presynaptic vesicles. So we know that increase in the catecholamines is responsible for insulin resistance both at the periphery as well as at the level of pancreas, where it decreases the insulin secretion. So because cilnidipine, you know, prevents the catecholamine release, it is postulated that it improves insulin sensitivity in those subgroup of patients. And there is also another hypothesis that cilnidipine prevents the hypertrophy of type 2 muscle fibers. And the type 2 muscle fibers are those who have less of the GLUT4 receptors, which is required for the glucose utilization. So this is one of the proposed mechanisms. There are animal studies which potentiate this. We don't have any data as far as humans are concerned. So how low should we go? So as we discussed earlier, the European Society says that 130 millimeters of mercury and lower if tolerated, but definitely not less than 120. And the AHA ACC guidelines mentioned that a target should be less than 130. This is reiterating the same fact. So what are the conclusions? So the blood pressure levels markedly influence the renal outcomes of patients with CKD, especially the proteinuric ones. And a goal blood pressure oriented management is mandatory for renal as well as cardiovascular protection. And in addition, use of RAS blocking agents is strongly recommended owing to their renal protective effect. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for a wonderful presentation on changing paradigm in the hypertension management with diabetes patient. So I request now there are 4-5 questions in the chat box. I will read out for you, sir. And meanwhile, any other questions are there, audience can ask in the chat box, or they can unmute themselves and ask to the speaker directly. In next 10 minutes, we will conclude the session. The first question is from Dr. Rushabh Harendra. Does it have greater increase in creatinine when we start azilsartan? Its effect on uric acid. So, Prakash sir, if you can answer this question.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I don't think azilsartan has any effect on the uric acid. not to my knowledge.
Yes, sir. And so there's one more follow-up question, that is it better in heart failure patients than ramipril?
Of course, if you compare the ACE inhibitor versus ARBs, then there is a definite evidence of cardiovascular benefit in favor of ACE inhibitor, that is ramipril. Whereas in favor of ARBs, you have a lot of evidence as far as the renal benefits are concerned. So if the if you have to decide which one is a more dominant factor in a hypertension subject, if the patient has LVH, has certain other risk factors like dyslipidemia, smoker, positive family history, and you think he has a very high cardiovascular risk, then I would definitely prefer ACE inhibitor like ramipril for hypertension. But if he does not have any of those other risk factors and his cardiovascular risk is not high, I would definitely prefer ARB.
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir, there is one more question. Which time of the day should adilsartan be used?
It's advised that the adilsartan should be taken early in the morning.
Okay, okay, sir. So the next question would be to Dr. Jagdeep Shah, sir. Can adilsartan 80 mg be started at CKD stage 2?
No, it is not recommended to start adilsartan with 80 milligram. Adilsartan has got a first dose hypotensive effect also. So because it's a very potent drug, even if there is a stage 2 or stage 3 hypertension, it is not recommended to start with 80 milligram. Like there have been incidents of sudden hypotension with 80 milligram of adilsartan. So it is not recommended to start with 80 milligram.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions if their audience can ask in next for 5 minutes, we are going to conclude the session. They can unmute themselves and ask a question directly also.
Hello, I'm Dr. Kirit Gada. I want to know, if blood pressure is not controlled with this adilsartan and cilnidipine, can diuretic be added? Diuretic.
Certainly, you have to try higher dose of the adilsartan and cilnidipine to a maximally tolerated dose. And if despite this two-drug combination, if the blood pressure is not on target, then definitely addition of the diuretic that is diuretic like chlorthalidone 12.5 milligram, which can be up titrated to 25 milligram, should be added.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think, sir, there are no more questions. I would really like to thank our all three speakers, especially, there's one more question from Dr. Shaleen. Is there any benefit of combining repaglinide and glimepiride in diabetic patients? Both are insulin secreting drug. So Dr. Shaleen Shah, this question is from you, from Dr. M.T. Sundarani.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
What was the question?
Is there any benefit of combining repaglinide and glimepiride in diabetic patients? Both are insulin secreting.
Repaglinide and glimepiride.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
Sir, your voice has gone. Hello. Yes, sir. Sir, your voice is not audible. I think you are mute. Yeah.
Repaglinide and glimepiride.
Can I have the question again?
Yeah, sir. So it is asked by Dr. M.T. Sundarani to you. Is there any benefit of combining repaglinide and glimepiride in diabetic patients? Both are insulin secreting.
Yeah, so as the question itself says, both have a similar mechanism of action. They are insulin secretagogues. So ideally, the combination of therapy should not be used. However, repaglinide is shorter acting in health, and it's usually used to control the postprandial blood glucose levels. So the target of glimepiride is both fasting as well as postprandial sugars, while repaglinide is specifically for the postprandial sugars. So although the combination of both together is not warranted, in specific group of people, you may have to use a combination, especially patients who are on steroids with a, you know, those who have a higher postprandial sugar. So in certain conditions, yes, they can be used, but routinely not.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So I think, sir, I would like to conclude this session. I would personally like to thank all our three eminent speakers, Dr. Prakash Vazirani, sir, Dr. Jagdeep Shah, sir, and Dr. Shalin Shah, sir, for wonderful lucid presentation on various topics related to diabetes, hypertension, and CKD. So this has been really an academic feast for all the doctors who have attended today out of busy schedule. I would like to congratulate our team. Today, at one point of time, there were more than 80 doctors attending on a working day. Across the Gujarat, doctors have attended, and it really marks the success of this program. So thank you, sir. It's because of good topic and good talk from your side. At the same time, I would like to thank all the audience who have taken a time from their busy schedule and attendees invested their time in this academic and knowledge sharing platform. I would also personally like to request you to take care of yourself in this COVID times. You guys are at forefront fighting this COVID war, and at maximum risk, sacrificing so many things. I mean, while people were sitting at their home enjoying lockdown, you were really at the forefront. I mean, so personally, from bottom up my heart, I would like to thank you and also wish you all the luck and care. Do take care of yourself, and do let us know where we can be useful. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Good night, sir.
Good night. Good night.
Good night. Good night, everyone.
Good night.